There's a neuron, and that's a myelin sheath we're gonna talk about. Where's a myelin sheath? Well, these things look like marshmallows. Seen a marshmallow on a stick? That's an image that you could use to help you remember myelin sheath, like a little marshmallow on a stick. What stick? The axon, that projection outward that transmits information, an antenna-like structure. So I have the cell body here, obviously, containing my nucleus and my organelles and so on, intracellular fluid. And then I got these projections out here, which are dendrites. Right, these dendrites, now not every neuron looks like this. It depends on the kind of neuron that we're talking about, but they all have dendrites in the cell body and an axonal projection. And in that sense, they have similarities that we can talk about. So I've got this marshmallow looking thing, and you just see the marshmallows cut away here, so that what you have is a diagram of your dendrites, your cell body, and this axon, which is wrapped up by these myelin sheath cells, which are really Schwann cells. They're glial cells. They're support cells that help do a couple of things. And at the end of it, we got the terminal boutons, or the terminal knobs, or the synaptic knobs, or the synaptic buttons, whatever you want to call them. Basically, that is the end of the axon. And there's a physical space in which neurotransmitters are stored, such that if we get information at the dendrites, as we'll see, and repeat so that we make sure we understand it, that open up enough receptors that allow enough positive ions from the outside of the cell into the cell and build up enough of a charge to hit a threshold we'll talk about, it's going to fire a signal all the way down this axon, seemingly instantaneously, but we know that there's actual time involved. It's milliseconds. It's not a time we can really appreciate as people, because milliseconds are thousandths of a second. We can barely appreciate what a second is, 1,001. Imagine dividing that up 1,000 times, and you see what we're talking about on the order of time. But it's going to fire it down this axon, hit these terminal knobs, and cause little pouches we'll call vesicles full of neurotransmitter to fuse with the membrane and disgorge or dump those molecules into a thing we're going to call the synapse. And we're going to go over all of this again. Now, aside from just holding this thing up physically, the glial cells provide other functions. In this case, we've got these myelin sheaths that are punctuated by nodes of Ranvier. I don't know why they call it that. Probably somebody named Ranvier came up with that, right? It's just little spaces in between them is the way to look at it. The spaces in between them allow a more efficient transmission of electrical information. So I've got this over here chemical process of neurotransmitters hitting my dendrites, opening up or closing down receptor sites that allow extracellular ions in. Ions, positive and negative, y'all know positive ions and negative ions, cations, me, right? Some basic chemistry, but knowing plus and minus is sufficient. The positive charge coming in, if it reaches a sufficient threshold, it's going to fire an electrical impulse down this axon, causing what? Chemicals to be released. So we have an electrochemical means of transmitting information. And how are we going to make that more efficient? That impulse traveling down this axon will be helped along by what essentially acts as wire insulation. If you know anything about electricity, you know that you don't lay bare wires out, right? You insulate the wires to keep the signal from degrading, yes? To enhance efficiency. We have that here. Enhanced efficiency by essentially insulating the axon with these little marshmallow looking things, right? Which are glial cells that wrap themselves around the axon. And if you think about it, what's happening is this electrical impulse is skipping across here, across these nodes of Ranvier being relayed down until it reaches the terminal knobs. And if you think about that, another metaphor, another way to conceive of that is, how does this thing allow it to go faster? Well, imagine throwing a rock underwater. It doesn't go very far and it doesn't go very fast, right? That That energy gets degraded quickly and diffused. But what if you skip a rock across the top? It goes much farther, much faster. So thinking about the electrical transmission in that way, you can see that it's skipping across these nodes around VA to enhance the speed and efficiency of the signal transmission. And the terminal boutons are just the endpoints of the axons that are going to be part of the whole system. Glial cells, being still white font, you don't need to know the individual types. There are a lot of different types. Oligodendrocyte is just a fun thing to say. Oligodendrocyte. Y'all say oligodendrocyte. Yeah, isn't that fun? You don't need to know that, but that's just a funky name. Look like a giant octopus. And it's like a scaffolding. It's just holding out its arms in a way that makes it possible to prop up axons and dendrites in this brain mass. All this tissue is really just a mass of cells jumbled together. So we've got the oligodendrocytes. Oh, what are they doing? They're myelinating our axons. There's also the Schwann cell that's myelinating our axons. So which? There depends on your neuron. But the general sense is here, I've got this Schwann cell right here that is a cell in and of itself. You see its nucleus, and it in and of itself has wrapped itself around this axon. And then there's a little gap, and there's your next one. Got the oligodendrocyte out there stretching out to hold them all up. So you've got individual cells supporting individual cells in an integrated fashion. And you need them. You got to have them. We get into issues of signal degradation, like Parkinsonian syndrome, right? People lose the ability to control muscle because the signals start getting staticky and shaky and breaking up. So I had a student in here one time, a long time ago. He's paraplegic from the waist down, had suffered an accident, was an Army Ranger, I believe. Very adaptive guy, very on top of it. Post-discharge, got into an accident that severed the spinal column's ability to transmit information from inside to outside. So it was his efferent neurons that were affecting his inability to walk, but he also couldn't feel. That was the afferent neurons that were severed from the central nervous system. And I don't know if y'all ever watched Schoolhouse Rock. Y'all ever watched Schoolhouse Rock? It's old Schoolhouse Rock back in my day. You watch it on Saturday mornings before cartoons were on 24/7. And it's like a telegraph line. You got yours and I got mine. We call it the nervous system, right? It's like wires. If you cut the wires, they don't work anymore. And he had that moment of vividness. He's like, so my wires are cut. I said, exactly. Your wires are cut. If we could figure out how to restore the connection, theoretically, you could restore your feeling and your functionality. But at this moment, we don't know how to do that. We're working on it, and we've got some amazing prosthetic devices that function off of brain impulse, but it's not the same impulse that's going down the spinal cord, and we'll talk about the difference. But when you look at it that way, it's pretty easy to see that what we're talking about, and somebody says, are you getting on my last good nerve? What they're really saying is, you're getting on my last good bundle of axons. Because that's what your nerve is. It's not just one axon. It's thousands and thousands in a cable-like fashion projecting into different areas of the brain to do different kinds of functions. So you cut those, and you don't have the functionality anymore. Depending on what other kinds of damage may occur, you might kill off those cells en masse. In the case of brain trauma, blunt blows to the head, or things like stroke, lesions that occur because of a lack of oxygen or an occlusion of blood. This may not seem so damn exciting, but I'm telling you it is. It's amazing stuff. It should be able to help you connect a little bit better to your own experience in life, and maybe some of those you love. People who go through difficulties after unfortunate events like brain traumas or things like dementia, as we'll see, of the Alzheimer's type, which seems to have something to do with tau proteins and neurofibrillary tangles accumulating. Well, what are they talking about? They're talking about neuronal damage. They're talking about the function of the neuron being impeded by something physiological occurring that renders them either unable to do their job or kills them outright such that they can't do their job, obviously. The action potential I've already alluded to inside that neuron, in the cell body, intracellular fluid is in a negative state. Anions and cations, right? An being negative, cat being positive. If you need a mnemonic, an is negative. Cat got a T in it. I look at that as a plus, right? Plus sign, negative sign. You don't really need to know that per se, but what you have inside the cell is a state of negative electrical potential. So when we look at this membrane potential, we see a negative 60, a thing we would call resting potential. Now, it doesn't have to be negative 60 on every single neuron, but you get the gist. For different neurons, you get different variations on any of these things we might be talking about, with some exception. But basically, it's sitting there in a negative state, which means the outside of the cell is more positive relative to the inside of the cell. And there's a barrier keeping that positive charge outside and the negative state inside, because we know opposites attract, right? If you made it wide open, it would achieve equilibrium almost instantaneously. Not actually instantaneously. In milliseconds, we would have total equilibrium with regard to charge. So this is an active process. In fact, you start messing around with some of these variables, right? Electrolytes for one, and you render the neuron unable to function. You ever heard of anybody dying from drinking too much water? You put too much water in and you fail to have the electrolyte balance you need to represent the charge, right? Sodium, NaCl, you need that. Why? Because it's electrically potential. All right, it contributes to your electrical potentiality. So I've got inside my neuron this state of negativity, and outside I've got a state of relative positivity. The resting potential, negative 70, negative 50, whatever it may be. There's this thing called the all or none firing law. All this being under action potential. And what we're talking about is this dotted line right here. Neurotransmitters are floating around in the synapse, which we'll talk about in more detail in just a second. They're binding to receptors on the dendrites. Those dendrites are then opening or closing essentially portals, which we'll call receptors, opening and closing receptors. If it opens receptors, we got positivity coming in, don't we? Because now we have that barrier breached by design in a way that is allowing positive charge to come into our intracellular space, and our positive charge starts to accumulate. We're getting less and less negative, and we're moving towards this threshold. If we don't reach that threshold, neuron will never fire. The signal dies right there. It becomes nil. However, if we reach that threshold, bam, it's got to fire. Oh, it's got to go. No questions about it. If you reach the threshold, you get a signal. So you have a continuation of information. Started with the dendrites. Having no signal transpire is one kind of information. Having a signal passed on is another kind of information. Now, it's a fascinating metaphor to me to think about how complicated humans are and how complicated computers are. And what kind of information transmission do we talk about in computer language? Yeah, I don't know. Don't nobody know how a computer talks?
Binary.
Thank you, binary, exactly. Zeros and ones, right? Everything you see on that screen right now is what? Patterns of zeros and ones. That's all it is, but it's looking a lot more complicated than zeros and ones. But when you get down to the individual neuron level, what do you got? Zeros and ones, firings and no firings. It either fires or it doesn't fire. Patterns of zeros and ones that are summated in a way that we experience it as reality. External modeled internal, or internal translated to external. Zeros and ones. That's amazing, isn't it? I think it's amazing. I'm stunned. Maybe you're not stunned. That's okay. Takes a little bit of taking in to get the whole process. Well, boom! blown its wad, fired it all, took all that positivity, shot it down the axon, right? So as it discharges it, it drops again back into its negative state. There is a point right about here where it is now below its resting threshold. It's hyperpolarized, and it cannot fire during this state. That's a resting spot that you can't get out of rest. Absolute refractory period. Absolute refractory period simply means during that duration, and it's a relatively short duration, couple milliseconds, you can't get the thing to fire again. But it quickly returns to its resting potential, and you can do it again. So if you look at this as kind of a 10 millisecond framework for purposes of illustration, then what you see is the ability of this neuron to fire 100 times in a second, right? 10 milliseconds times 100 equals 1,000. We got a second. Isn't that right, math peoples? Not all of us is math peoples. I'm not a math people. I have to ask. That's amazing. How do we keep walking across the stage? Why don't we get depleted? Why don't these neurons just run out of neurotransmitter? How do they keep on going? That is amazing. How do I keep blinking the eye with the same neurons? Blinking, 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 blinking. I'll wear out my muscles before I run out of neurotransmitter and an action potential to cause that to happen. I'll get tired for other reasons besides my neuron being depleted that allows it to occur, right? That's stunning. That's how we function. And most people go about their day, of course, oblivious to this. How would you know? How could you know? And as I always say, what difference does it make? It should start to make a difference philosophically in realizing that every one of us has a unique computer that runs our cognitive processes and our physiological processes in which our metaphysical soul, assuming it exists, is housed. And that what we think to be reality is in fact an internal model that we construct. And who other people think we are may in fact be radically altered if any of this apparatus ceases to exist or ceases to function. You have people who have massive brain injuries that wind up with personality changes. People are like, that's not the same person I've always known. Well, soulfully, metaphysically, it's got to be the same person, right? But what you see is the manifestation of that is radically altered such that other people don't perceive them in the same way anymore, right? The people with ALS, who Dr. Sella's research is aiming to help, who have locked-in syndrome, who they are isn't changing, but their ability to move musculature is changing to the point that they can no longer move it at the worst state and they can no longer communicate. Inside, everything else is the same. Can you imagine being exactly who you are now and you can't move and you can't talk to anybody without the assistance of an electronic apparatus designed to translate what? Other electrical impulses from your brain into computer algorithms that allow you to interact with a computer that then allows you to interact with other people who have the exact same apparatus, but for whatever reason, it works for them and not for you. That's pretty profound, I think. I don't know. You may disagree. That's fine. I can only put it out there. I just throw these up here, the action potential. Let me give you a really heavy-duty graphic. Inside is negatives and outside is positives. I got neurotransmitters, which we're going to talk about more extensively in a minute, that are interacting with my dendrites. Look at my little NA cations floating around there. Well, if the right neurotransmitter locks up with the right receptor, that receptor may open, and that opening allows the cations to come in and change the polarity, which allows that rising potential until we reach threshold, at which point they open up wide open, and bam! Fire that down. All or none. 0-1.